This morning's scripture lesson is the Gospel of Peter, verses 7 through 11. Please listen to the word of God. After the Lord's body was placed in the tomb of Joseph, I and my companions were grieved, and being wounded in mind, we hid ourselves, for we were being sought for by the authorities and malefactors, and as wishing to set fire to the temple. And upon all of these things we fasted and sat mourning and weeping night and day until the Sabbath was over. But the scribes and Pharisees and elders, being gathered together one with another, when they heard that all the people murmured and beat their breasts, saying, "If by his death these most mighty signs have come to pass, we see how righteous he is," the elders were afraid and came to Pilate, beseeching him and saying, "Give us soldiers, that we may guard his sepulchre for 3 days, lest his disciples come and steal him away, and the people suppose that he has risen from the dead and do us evil." And Pilate gave them Petronius the centurion, with soldiers to guard the tomb. And with them came elders and scribes to the sepulchre, and having rolled a great stone together with the centurion and the soldiers, they all together set it at the door of the sepulchre, and they affixed 7 seals around it, and they pitched a tent there and guarded it, and stayed early in the morning as the Sabbath ended. And in the night, in which the Lord's day was drawing on, as the soldiers kept guard 2 by 2 in a watch, there was a great voice in the heaven, and they saw the heavens opened, and 2 men descended from thence with great light and approached the tomb. And that stone which was put at the door rolled off itself and made way in part. And the tomb was opened, and both the young men entered in. When those soldiers saw this, they awakened the centurion and the elders, for they too were nearby keeping guard. And as they declared what things they had seen, again they saw 3 men come forth from the tomb, and 2 of them supporting another, and a cross following them. And of the 2, their heads reached up to the heavens, but the head of him that was led by them overpassed the heavens. And the onlookers heard a voice from the heavens saying, "Thou hast preached to them that sleep?" And a response was heard from the cross, "Yea." They therefore considered one with another whether to go away and shew these things to Pilate. And while the soldiers yet thought thereon, the heavens again were seen to open, and a certain man was seen to descend and enter into the sepulchre. When the centurion and they that were with him saw these things, they hastened in the night to Pilate, leaving the tomb which they were watching, and declared all things which they had seen, being greatly distressed, and saying, "Truly, he was the Son of God."
Let us pray. Lord, thank you for coming, for showing us the way, showing us that no matter how bad things get, if we suffer unto death, we should be resurrected. That love will find a way, that life is everlasting. Lord, help us to find this story in our lives every day, and use your example to overcome all of our struggles, to resurrect every day like the rising sun, with a new life, a new perspective, to be born again. So, Easter is here. Happy Easter.
What?
Thank you. What a great day. What a great sermon. It's easy, you know, it should be really easy for me to do Easter sermon, right? Easter is kind of the whole point of the faith, the crucifixion and the resurrection. It's a great holiday. Now, some people might not say, well, we need, like the kids might say, "Oh, Christmas is better," right? Because you got the presents. But then, of course, a good pastor would say, "Well, you can't have Christmas. It wouldn't be important without Easter." But then the city to me might also say, "Well, yeah, but you can't have Easter without Christmas, And then you have a chip and egg thing. But I guess that brings us back to Easter, right? And Easter is kind of the reason for the season. It's this great story, and it should be a very easy sermon for me to preach. Because all I have to do is preach the gospel. Preach the story. We know this story. Jesus went down and he came back up. You know what? That there's a hub. I don't want to hurt anybody's ears. So Jesus came down and he went back up. It's a simple story. It's a story that's so familiar I can just stick with it. In fact, most of you probably, well not most of you, some people came here on Easter Sunday just to get their Christmas Christian fix. In pastoral terms, you're called priesters, Christmas and Easter. Maybe you came because your parents dragged you. You came, and it really doesn't matter what you say, what I say. You didn't come to be challenged. We just tell that old story. I mean, how does that song go? I love to tell the story, 'twill be my theme and glory, to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. It's a simple story, and we can tell it over and over again, and that would make my sermon easy. But that's part of the problem, is that it's such a familiar story that we're so used to it, that the idea of someone raising up every Easter isn't that spectacular. It's become kind of mundane. Or for some people, it might have just become absurd. And they still may be good Christians and strive to follow Jesus, but when it comes to something like the resurrection, they nod their heads in the Easter service, but they're really here for the music, and their thoughts are more on the Easter egg. Because it's hard to convey this old story in a new way. How do I show the joy of Easter? How do I express the miracle and the majesty of the resurrection? How do I tell the sheer surprise and awe of what happened on that Easter morning? Well, I thought about it, and I thought, you know, with those kids, you saw how they were kind of surprised when the candles lit up, and the hallelujahs went in the air. Kids are often surprised. Wouldn't it be amazing if we could read the gospel like that? We could view the stories of the Bible, the resurrection, for the first time. Maybe even, heck, see the whole world like that for the first time. I got a question for you. Have you ever seen a four-year-old hit the snooze button on the alarm clock and just say, "Yeah, I'm not going to." No! Every morning they wake up, bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, knocking on your door, jumping on your bed. It's like they're so excited to be alive. They're so surprised that it's another day and the sun came up again. It's all new. It's amazing. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we could be like that? If we could have that again in our lives. So I started thinking about how to do this with the Easter story. How amazing that must have been for the original disciples. The people that never heard this story before, not expecting it. And there Jesus was in all his glory. Well, so let me ask you another question. What do you think of today's scripture? Or maybe more specifically, how many of you knew that the gospel of Peter is not in the Bible? Now, I anticipate three answers to this. I was going to go along the theme. We just went through the Passover from the Jewish tradition. And in Jewish tradition, when they did the Passover meal, there are four children, and they're considered four characters who ask questions. And the first one is very smart, and he asks lots of questions. The second one is a little slow, and his questions are kind of vague. The third guy is kind of wicked. He just wants to eat, and his questions are belligerent. And the last kid doesn't ask any questions. Now, I'm going to assume that nobody here is with me. So I'm going to assume that there are three people, kinds of people here. There are people that didn't know that the Gospel of Peter was not in the Bible. And I'm not going to condemn you for it, but you might have outed yourself as one of these priesters, these kind of Christmas Christians. And I would suggest you come back. You might learn something. There's a lot of great wisdom. And then, for those of you who did know that the Gospel of Peter was not in the Bible, when you heard this story today, what did you think? What did you feel? What did you notice? How was it different? How was it the same? What was the surprise? And lastly, I think there's probably some people who weren't really paying that much attention, who might not have heard it or wouldn't even looked at it really in the bulletin or even realized what they were hearing. And for you, I think that is the people I want to get to, how to open our eyes and really pay attention. Because, heck, you could have just been committing heresy right now and didn't even realize it. So, with this story, we need to open our eyes and try to view everything from a new perspective. So let's look at this gospel, and the Gospel of Peter is just a fragment. It's about 10 verses, chapters. It's about 2 pages long, and they found it in a tomb of a monk from the 9th century. And it's referenced in much older writings. And when they looked at the composition of it, some people say it might have been written as early as 50 years AD. Might have been one of the first Gospels written. Some people think it was probably written later than that, or it was written, a lot of these Gospels were written earlier than that, but then they were influenced later and rewritten. And so it's an old document, and a lot of the theologians who talked about it in the past did warn about it, because it is heretical. One of the things that it talks about, not in what we read, but in a few other verses, it talks about Jesus being more of a ghost or a spirit. And when he dies on the cross, he's like an illusion. But then, the other thing that I think is really interesting about this story, one thing it teaches us about the other Gospels, our Gospels, that I never realized, was that in our Gospels, there is no resurrection story. Meaning, there is stories of an empty tomb, and there are stories after the empty tomb of Jesus appearing. But in this Gospel, it actually tells the story of Jesus coming and moving the boulder. And it tells what happens to the soldiers and the people who are guarding the temple. It even gives them a name. And I think that's fascinating. And it makes me wonder, what really did happen on that day? How did the tomb become open? How did Jesus resurrect? Did he walk out? Did he fly out? Do you tell me what really happened? And also, then it gets into some strange stuff. It talks about these two men who come in, and it says their heads reached all the way up to heaven. And then they come out with a third person, possibly Jesus, and it says his head reached above the heavens. And it just sounds weird. And then following them is the cross. And you're not quite sure, does the cross have feet? Is it floating? And then a voice from heaven says, have you preached to the sleeping or the dead? And then the cross talks. And that's all really strange. But that's not necessarily that much more strange than some of the stuff that's in our regular Bible. And that's what I want us to realize, is that there are amazing miracles. There are mysteries all throughout our faith that can uplift us, that we can think upon. The question is, how well do we read our own scripture? For example, do you know that in the footnotes of the Gospel of Mark, it ends with the empty tomb and the wicked see the tomb, and they walk away and they run away and they tell no one. The rest of the resurrection stories of Mark were added later, according to the notes. Did you know that the women are always the first ones to see the resurrected Jesus? And most of the time, the men don't believe them. Interesting, isn't it? There's a lot of things that we don't realize. Whenever I like to tell people who say, oh yeah, I know the scriptures back and forth, straight and forward, I can give you a little teaser. Do you know there's a naked man who streaks in the Garden of Gethsemane? Check out the Gospel of Mark. It's in there. So, there's a lot of stuff, but when we read it closer, and we take it seriously, we can learn so much more. And suddenly, a whole world opens up to us. So let's look at this story anew. Let's look at this story like children, afresh. Jesus is risen. What does that mean? What new inspiration do we gather from it? You know, I think one of my favorite sayings is, our faith, our religion is 2,000 years old, but our thinking is not. Think about that. Jesus resurrected from the dead. Did God raise the dead? Would you bet your life on it? Well, I think one of the amazing things about the gospel and our faith is that it leaves room for the impossible. In fact, one of the early sayings of the church fathers was, I believe because it is impossible. It leaves room for possibilities. It's not a denial of science. It's an opening up of the mind. If you believe in science and you believe in religion, then you got the best of both worlds. You have a practical education, but you also know that there's more to this world out there. That more things are possible than we could ever imagine. And so you could search for more things through science and through prayer. You could fight for justice and peace, even when all logic says that might not come true. You could look at the world anew every day. And I think that is maybe the point of the entire resurrection, is that every day is a new day. Every day we are born again. We go into sleep. It's like a mini death. Then by the grace of God, we wake up. The sun rises again. We have a new opportunity. Through Christ, we are forgiven. Through Christ, we can celebrate this life without fear of death, because we know that death is not the end. So we don't have to worry about it. We can focus on what we have now and make it the best it can possibly be. Christ is alive so we can live. Christ has risen so we can rise and see the world in a new light a new perspective. Yeah.